I'm here with Bad Boys Blue Kennel. I'm kind of like the co-owner, I guess you would say, maybe? I guess.
Absolutely.
Obviously, this is Wildwilly, the man, the myth, and the legend. You want to introduce yourself here, Paul?
Yep, I'm William David McMonigal Jr., otherwise known as Wildwilly.
I'm also known as Wildwilly, right? You know, a lot of people call me David, you know, on a more personal note and whatnot. And today, we guys are going to be bringing you an epic story, the story that's going to change coon hunting, the beginning of it all. What we're going to do here is we're just going to go with my dad, and we're just going to I want you to tell me how you got into the sport. You know, I want you to tell them how you got into the sport. A lot of people have been affected by what we're doing. A lot of dogs have been saved, okay? But it always starts at a point. So let's just start from the beginning, you know what I mean? When did you first go hunting? When did you first experience in the coon hunting sport, you know?
Well, years ago when I was probably 10, 11, 12, I used to go with my best friend, Kenny Martin. And I hated it every night. We cut the dogs loose and we spend the whole rest of the night catching dogs. And even then, I loved every part of it except for catching the dogs. But I didn't realize we was getting all the young dogs. But I remember clear back then thinking, if I can add my obedience to this sport, it would change it forever. And we hunted a lot. The coon got distemper. Everything died out.
What's distemper now?
Distemper is a disease. One of the reasons why we have to vaccinate our dogs.
Okay.
And
so that just kind of wiped out the population of the coon. All of them.
Gone. Yeah, for 10 years we couldn't treat coon.
Heck, you can't even go 3 minutes without seeing one on the road, so I wouldn't know what that's like, but I'd imagine it sucked for a coon hunter. You know, how did you go from not being able to hunt anymore at all to getting back into the sport? When did that go by? You know, what happened there? Especially because you said you didn't like it very much, you know?
Well, back in we loved it, but I mean, we loved hunting, but it didn't seem like we was making any progress. Just nothing controlled. Dogs running around everywhere, and after 2 months or 3 months, you know, they get doing a little better. But it was just the thing of taking a dog to the woods, watching it improve. Taking a dog to the woods, watching it improve.
No structure.
None.
No training.
Yeah, so when they did improve, man, the hairs on the back of your neck would stand up because now you got this.
Okay.
But we hunted and hunted and hunted, but it just didn't have that glamour to it.
When did you first get your dog? Okay, so after this distemper came about, you know, let's move into, when did you first get that new dog where you kind of changed it up? Or, you know, when was kind of like your first time back into it where you decided to make it different than what you had seen or what you know? You know what I mean?
Let me explain. What happened was, this coon come back and I started coon hunting again. Same old thing. Running dogs and you know, why can't we teach this dog to heel? You can't do that. My best friend, Kenny, you can't do that with these dogs. Well, I dabbled in it and at the same time, I'm training dogs to do all sorts of things. English Mastiffs to play red light, green light with toddlers. Dogs to kill people. But if I say drop, the person can lick it.
Right.
And the dog will lick the person.
That's great.
Many different breeds. But I'd gotten electrocuted, and they'd give me 2 to 5 years to live. And Kenny talked me into riding with him because he was going and getting a blue tick from Grayson Paul.
I didn't even want to go.
I mean, he about twisted my ear to get me to go. I was just thinking about how not to die. Well, we got up there and met one of the nicest people you'd ever meet on the face of the earth.
Who's that?
Grayson Paul.
Grayson? Oh, I love Grayson.
Grayson Paul.
He bought me a dinner one night at a coon hunt. I remember that.
Thank you, Grayson. Yes, thank you, Grayson.
So you're taking Brussels from him, and you know, and you're getting him home, and I'd imagine you obedience trained him a little bit. I know you did. But So you're taking him and you're obedience training him and you're hunting him. You know, when did you kind of first realize that they could be combined to make a dog that's, you know, perfect? Because a lot of the training we've done has started from this point. So it's very important for people to know, you know, why it, you know, how it came to be. What was the first dog that really ever went through our training? And it was Brussels. So, you know, what was it like when you first realized, you know, what was that moment like when you first kind of knew that it could be combined?
Well, first I was challenged.
Okay.
Brussels followed me around that whole weekend, everywhere. And I wanted him. I wanted him bad.
Right.
But I'm disabled. Workman's comp. I didn't even know how I could feed him, but I wanted him bad, and Grayson knew it. Right before I left, and I thought of different ways. I wonder if I could offer him a little bit of money in the future. What? I'm thinking all these ways, and he's reading my mind. I know he is. And that pup followed me everywhere. Everywhere I went, all the rest of the pups, 20 of them, they just do whatever. That dog followed me everywhere. And every time I'd look at him, he'd look me right straight in the eyes. We went to leave, and Grayson's like, Willie, that pup picked you. You take him. You take him home and hunt him, your health will improve. It's like Grayson. They just told me I got congestive heart failure. I want that dog, but I don't know that I'd be able to do anything with him. He's like, I don't care. Just take him home. You can send me some money here or there. It's like, well, what would you want? He's like, 150 puppies. And I'm thinking, yeah, how long would it take me to send him $150 on? It's like, Grayson, I don't know how long it'll take me to pay you. I don't know how long. He's like, I don't care. You just take him, send me $5, $10, make sure you buy diapers for your baby, and just send me what you can when you can.
Right, okay.
I told him again, I said, Grayson, I don't know how long this would take. He said, I don't care. Willie, if I'm in my deathbed, I'm not going to set up and say you owe me money. The dog picked you, take him home. If you can never pay me, I'm happy.
Right.
He stuck him with a rabies shot, throwed him up into the truck, and away we went. And right before he left, I told him, I'll take him if I can teach him obedience. And I'll never forget that. That's where the challenge was. He looked me straight in the eyes. He's like, well, you can't train dogs like this.
Right.
They're not like that. And I said, I don't understand, Grayson. I can train any dog anything I want. Why can't I train these dogs something? He's like, you'll see later when you get him. It's just something you can't do. And I told him, I said, Grayson, when I come back here, if I can come back, that dog will hold steak on his nose as long as I tell him. And when I tell him, he'll throw it up and catch it.
Right.
He shook his head thinking I was an idiot. Now, this man won the first Lifetime Achievement Award for better than the blue tick breed. He owned the first night champion blue tick in UKC history, Merrimack's Blue Bid. This man has told me stories that I thought was insane, and later come to find out every single one of them was true. Everyone. Well, watching him shaking his head like, I am just never going to make any progress with this dog because I don't understand these breeds. All the way home, 4.5 hours, I started designing and training. What I knew, seeing dogs cut loose and go,
okay,
to what I know how to train other dogs to do. And that's when it started. Now, I believed him. When I got home, he went outside on a chain and he stayed there for 2 weeks. I played with him. I socialized him.
Right. Okay.
Right? I couldn't walk but 10 feet at a time. So I spent time with him. And then I decided, for real, I'm going to do it my way. I don't care if he can't learn any of this and what everybody says is true, then he can't. It ain't going to hurt him. So I started training. And the first 15 minutes, he knew how to sit down, lay down, and nearly healed off lead. And it blew my mind.
They didn't realize the potential that the dog had.
Dog didn't have the inability to learn. He was so bullheaded that you didn't think he could. But once I got through that bullheadedness, I had him at 7 months old. For 2 weeks, he stayed outside. After 2 weeks, I realized how smart he was. He came inside. In 1.5 months, he was completely obedience trained, including hand signals, and every time you cut him, he'd tree his own coon. and you couldn't pry him off a tree.
Dang.
Then I knew right then and there that these dogs were smarter. Not a little bit, they were more intelligent than any other breed I'd ever touched. I'd never seen a dog learn this fast, but they're so bullheaded I had to get through that. So I started incorporating more positive reinforcement so the dog wants to use his intelligence and do what it is I want him to do. And then it exploded. It wasn't another month and we made the trip back to Grayson's. And we went there and I asked him, I said, you remember what I told you I was going to teach this dog to do? And he shook his head. I said, Brussel, and he sat down. I said, Brussel, and he laid down. I said, Brussel, and he upset. Then I took a piece of steak, it was actually a piece of jerky, and I put this big old chunk on his nose right there. I set it there, told him to stay, and I left. Grayson went nuts. He got his wife, his family, his buddies, they all come, they're watching him. They can't believe it. I left. This dog, I believe, was 9 months old at this time.
Man.
No, he'd have been like not quite 10 months old. Grayson's reaction of seeing his blood do things he never believed before burned a hole in me so hard, I can't stop. These dogs are more intelligent than any other dogs I've touched. They learn with record speed, but they're so smart they know how to get away with anything they don't. So they've always had this little hinge of they can't do it, they can't do this. Well, I'm here to tell you, they can do anything any dog can do, and they can do it better.
And I mean, I've seen it.
Yes.
And I've seen a lot of this. But what I want to do is I want to take us back to the hunting aspect, because what I want to focus on is, so you've taken him and you've obedience trained him and stuff like that. But when was the first time you saw this obedience and this training that you have put into him really click over, and you knew, like in the woods, you knew that this training system can be used for millions of dogs, you know? I want to know kind of like, so you're sitting there and Brussels doing all this obedience, and I know you're incorporating it into the woods as you see it and stuff like that, but when did it really hit you that these dogs can really be changed hunting ability-wise, using training more so than just obedience, but you can improve their hunting, because hunting is a form of long-range obedience.
I'll never forget it. Brussels 11 months old. My buddy talked me into taking him to a hunt because he wanted to breed his female to different dogs.
Okay.
We checked out 5 dogs. We traveled, we brought home, hunted. At the end of it, he's like, I'm breeding to Brussel. And I said, you can't do that. You can't register pups. He's only 11 months old. He said, I don't care. And I've done seen 5 different dogs, and none of them are as nice as Brussel in the woods. I'm breeding to him. I'm going to hunt what we have. I don't care about papers. Right. So we didn't even know we could register. Well,
dang.
So we end up breeding him, and he's like, he's not only got to be bred, he's got to be hunted.
Right.
I've hunted coon dogs my whole life. I've never seen a dog like this, really. He's 11 months old.
Dang. Oh, that's crazy.
Oh, he was flat amazing. you could shoot a coon to another dog, and he wouldn't leave his tree. He wouldn't even look. When he treed, the world died. It ended.
Right.
But I'd been doing some obedience training that I hadn't really known just what I was getting the result. I didn't know it yet. But then we took him to a hunt. The first night, he's the only dog that treed a coon. He treed 5, and yet I lost.
They mess you up. They get you on them points, didn't they?
Oh, man. They told me I was calling the wrong dog. Everything you could imagine. There was only one dog that ever strayed or treed a coon, and he was the only dog that was there at the tree. Even after the hunt, we had to cross a flooded river to get him off of a tree. And when we got back to the club, the men apologized to me. They couldn't believe what they just seen. They just couldn't stop trying to win during the hunt. Then after the hunt, they realized what they just witnessed. An 11-month-old pup with the 1 of 3 Grand Night champions. But I didn't know that I was instilling it. But what did happen, I had to go back Saturday, like a dork. I had to go back, because I should have won that night. The first woods, first strike, Brussel, first tree. Big old loud mess.
Oh,
big,
no.
Yep, and I didn't know nothing about the hunts. And he's getting ate up.
Dang. Right.
We go to the next one, and I didn't really know what was going on. This is the second hunt I've ever been in my life. We cut them again, and then you hear Brussel hush up. And I don't know nothing, right?
Yeah.
Now, Kenny's telling me a truck, something's going on. Something's trying to get Brussel. We already know he's clean, right?
Right,
but
okay.
When we get on the next truck, the judge, he took me off to the side, and he said, Willie, he's like, I know it's not your dog. He goes, I'm trying to catch it, but I'm telling you, you could ruin this dog for life if you keep hunting. I'm not telling you to withdraw. I'm telling you, you're damaging your dog, and I can't catch the ill dog.
Okay.
It's light broke, something, but I know what's going on.
Okay.
Okay?
So yeah, I got you.
Yes. So I listened to him. He was talking from the heart. I was still winning the hunt.
Dang, even with
But I withdrew him. Because my friend told me it was wrong. This judge told me, talking from the bottom of his heart, he'd never seen a young dog like this. Please don't get him ruined. It was too late.
Okay, so.
No, check this out. It was too late. So the very next time I take Brussel to the woods and a dog comes in and backs him, if it's a dog that moves much, Brussel quits treeing. It's done. I done ruined him. So now every time a dog comes to the woods and trees with him, okay, he won't tree.
Okay, so this got to be the beginning of the tree pressure. So now we're starting to get into tree pressure.
Yes. Now, let me explain this. Now, I don't know what I'm going to do. All I know is I've got an 11-month-old dog by himself is absolutely phenomenal. But if other dog's backing, I'm getting minus. I can't hunt him again. It's over.
Okay.
Now, if any dog comes in, he's not going to leave, but he's just going to circle the tree and not bark. Well, it's done. So, I thought about it, and it's like, okay, Willie, now wait a second. I'm training this dog all sorts of stuff. If he can learn sign language, then why can't I teach him that if something comes in there and wants to eat him, he ain't allowed to leave that tree? It took me not 15 minutes, not 15 minutes of my time, and right then and there, I invented tree pressure.
Tree pressure.
15 minutes. The very next day, we went out and we started on tree pressure. At the end of a 10-minute session, you couldn't pry that dog off of a tree. If another dog was treeing on his back, it was over.
Yeah.
In 15 minutes, I took a dog that was ruined to immaculate tree pressure. Dogs could eat him. They could eat him. And all he would do is tree, but he wouldn't leave. Right then and there. After that first session, I knew obedience training should have always been part of coon hunting. They are one and the same. Long-range obedience is coon hunting. The dog has to stay for the man to get there. This is a symbiote relationship. This is why it has taken so long for obedience to come into the sport, because it is the hardest sport. The hardest sport in the world is to train your dog to consistently do what you want when you snap the leash. Right then and there I knew, and right then and there I've been blending every aspect of my obedience training to the art of coon hunting, and anything any man can imagine his coon hound to do can be done with some obedience training.
And I'm going to stop you right there. Okay, so that's kind of the beginning of how it all started with the tree pressure. And how I love that story. I love hearing that story. But, I don't know. You know, we'll get more into that later. You know, I feel like that's a real nice spot to kind of ease in on that, because that is the beginning.
That is. Tree pressure.
Is the beginning.
Yeah.
And that's crazy thinking of where it expanded from there. And thinking about how that right there affected my life. Because I know coming into my own personal story with coming into coon hunting and stuff like that is obviously by the time I was born, he had already had Brussel. I think me and Brussel were about almost the same age. We were almost the exact same age. 13 and 13 when he passed away, I was 13. I'm pretty sure. So I kind of grew up seeing Brussel get trained. So a lot of this stuff that I know and stuff like that's grown up from learning it. You know, learning your dad's trade, as they would call it. Or learning the trade from seeing it. And I saw a lot of it. And a lot of it was like you know, a miracle to me, and but it became natural to me. It really did. It became infused with the way I started. So starting coon hunting was a lot different than when you started coon hunting. For you, was a way different than when I started. When I started, I can remember going with Russell, and I can remember him healing on your side. You know? Yeah. Now, I don't think I did a whole lot of coon hunting. Not a lot, you know, in my early age. I do remember hunting with Russell and stuff like that. But I think here recently, in the last 3 or 4 years, is when you'd said really got into it. Because with the training that we've been doing and stuff like that, I saw the potential and the amazingness that it is for saving these dogs. And I love animals, you know. So, you know, I really kind of got into it then. And but at the beginning, I had a few dogs, but nothing I really was committed to. My dog Precious, she'd probably be the first dog that I really got and I fell in love with. She's in my room, she's on my bed all the time, you know what I mean? She'd be my daughter, but she's when I really fell in love with it. But even then, I didn't really take to the hunting side of it. I was always more of a bench person, but Yukon was the beginning for me. Yukon really was. I trained Yukon all the way out, you know, sit down, lay down, all of it. But I really got into hunting with Yukon. You know, training your own dog really helps you with that.
Yeah.
And my point of view was going in with all already knowing how to train a lot of this stuff. It was different for me because I expected a little more than what you'd probably expect in the beginning.
Just a little. A lot.
I did. And I think it humbled me because I also had to realize that that's stuff you have to train for, and it's not something that just happens. It's not something that's... I thought seeing Brussels, I thought dogs were like that. I didn't grow up with the opinion dogs were dumb. I grew up with the opinion they were smart. They could do anything. They really couldn't. And that's true, and I thank you for giving me that opinion. But I think also I needed Yukon to kind of knock me down because it was training him, and he had troubles opening up on track at first and stuff like that, and we having to do training for that and all this training, you know, but really training him to the end is what got me into the hunt more of, because when I took him to my first hunt, and I didn't get any minus on my first hunt, I will add, but I had a pretty good teacher, I would say, but no, I really got into it with Yukon, and you know, I saw that these dogs need to be worked with, but once they're worked with, they're completely different. They understand you. They become a part of your body. They want to please you, and a dog does best what it wants to do. So if you make him want to do what you want to do, you're like brothers. You're like father and son, you know? You're really more bonded than just you and your dog.
Yes.
And, you know, I know you know that, and you kind of saw how it affected me, but, you know, it really did give me that impact to where I realized, okay, if you work hard and even just put a little more training, 15 minutes in your dog a day of obedience or, you know, just simple training, stuff like that, you can have a completely different dog experience. Everything's changed. The way you view dogs in general, the way you view animals, the way you view life itself can be changed by something as simple as putting a pinch chain on your dog and training it. And I really figured that out with Yukon. And I took him to my first hunt, and he treed one coon. It was writing a log. I never even imagined that. I walked up and I was like, "What's my dog doing?" "Oh no, you know, he's training. It's not even as tall as him. He's marking over the tree. It's cut in half." And I'm like, "What in the world?" You know, "Oh God." So I go in there, and sure enough, you look in there. There's the coon, bright as day, just right in the hole, right in the tree, right in the. I mean, you can see it. And I mean, when I got that meat, it lit the passion in me, knowing that training I put in had paid off. And you know, and I think that's kind of how I, you know, first started really loving to hunt and seeing the difference it made on my life. And I think that's a really good ending point, you know? I think that, that kind of wraps up the beginning of us
moment,
as hunters.
In that moment, what you experienced was your dog, Yukon, becoming a true extension of yourself.
And
when
I can...
you experience training in this way, you have all of the ability the dog has at a mere verbal command. And that, my son, is addictive.
Now, off of that note, I can tell you right now that that is true. You know, at that point, I realized it. And I think you guys might think we're crazy, but let me tell you what. You take these dogs through the training. You take the dogs through the training, even just a little bit. You will see results that will blow your mind, and your whole entire hunting experience will be different. We guarantee you that. I saw it with my dog, he saw it with his dog, and you can see it with your dog. So, we want to end it here, and we thank you for joining us on this this great journey with us, and this book, and this movie, and we look forward to fully helping you train your dog and letting you have that full experience with your dog at home.
We will blow your mind on what your community